شرقت نفسي بنور من فؤادي حينما رددت يا رب العباد، وانتشت روحي وصار الدمع يجري.
اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا رب العالمين. اللهم افتح علينا نعمتك وانشر علينا رحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تعالى: فبما رحمة من الله لنت لهم ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. وقال عليه وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أكمل المؤمنين إيمانا أحسنهم خلقا. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: ما من شيء أثقل في الميزان من حسن الخلق يوم القيامة. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: وعدت لأتمم حسن الأخلاق أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. We begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, the most magnificent, our Lord, our Creator, our Sustainer, our Nourisher. And we bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and messenger. Whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, none can misguide him. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misguides, none can guide him. We seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from shaitan, the accursed, and from the evils of our own souls. Last week we talked about backbiting and talked about the evils of backbiting and how to avoid the situations wherein we fall into backbiting and talking about other people, making fun of other people, talking about other people, slandering other people, what they wore, what they did, what they said. And we spoke about a few situations where we could easily fall into and how to avoid those situations. And just generally we spoke about how to save ourselves from the sins which are committed through the means of the mouth or through the means of speech. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when we look into his life, we find that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a complete human being, an amazing human being, the best creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as human beings, as Muslims, our role model is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is following him in every footstep, in every step of our life, to follow the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, one of the deceptions that I find, and towards being like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obviously, is in following his manners, his behaviors, his etiquettes, and this will lead us and help us naturally to stay away from all those sins, the sins of backbiting, the sins that are committed through means of speech, the sins which are committed through any limb of the body. The easiest way is generally to follow the lifestyle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's an easy equation. You follow the lifestyle, the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and inshallah you will be on the straight path. But just something that's holding back the Muslim community as a whole is this general deception of what being religious means. Unfortunately, in the Muslim community, amongst Muslims, if somebody becomes religious, it's because he starts praying, or it's because he paid his zakah, or because he's fasting during the month of Ramadan. And so we kind of hold religiousness or following religion to just a few aspects of deen. So if a person starts praying or pays his zakah or he starts fasting, we in ourselves or that person in himself thinks that he's completely following deen, 100% of deen. Whereas the foundation of deen, yes, is upon our salah and upon our zakah and upon our fasting and our iman. But this is just the foundation of our deen, not the complete deen. And this is where the deception occurs. We may think that maybe because he started fasting, and maybe because he's praying, and maybe because he paid his zakah, maybe because he's frequenting the masjid more often, maybe because he stopped doing all the things that he used to do, we feel that he's completely following deen, and he's completely 110% on the deen of Islam, on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the person himself may also think the same thing. But this is a deception in the sense that the complete deen is not only in following and praying salah and in paying our zakah. Yes, that's a great part of deen. Yes, it's a very important part of deen. Yes, it's the foundation of deen. But just like when a house is built, if the house is only built with foundation without the rest of the house, and just the foundation of the house is there, then the house is of no use. And in the same way, if there's the external beauties of the house is there, but with no foundation, then that house is also of no use. So it's important that we fulfill all aspects of deen. And the aspect of deen that we usually fall out on, or the aspect of deen that we usually are a little bit deficient in regards to, is akhlaq, is good manners, is etiquette and formality that we find is a part of deen. Unfortunately, our akhlaq today, it is in contrast to the akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our akhlaq today contradicts the ethical teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hence, we give a bad perception to Islam because of the way we deal with other people in our daily lives. The way that we deal with our co-workers, our family, our neighbors, the people that we deal with on a daily basis, because of the deficiency that we find in our akhlaq, it puts a bad perception on Islam. And when we look into the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the different the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in regards to the importance of akhlaq, in regards to the importance of good behavior and manners and etiquettes, the books of ahadith are full. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in a hadith reported by Imam Bukhari, "Bu'ithtu li'utammima makarim al-akhlaq," that I have been sent to this world to fulfill good akhlaq, or to show what good akhlaq exactly is. And good akhlaq, obviously, it covers a large topic: being kind, forgiving, being loving, being caring, being kind, being humble, being merciful, the way a person conducts himself, the way a person deals with other people. This is all under the umbrella of akhlaq. A hadith reported by Imam Tirmidhi, Aisha radiallahu anha, once said that the Prophet ﷺ said that verily the most complete believer in regards to his iman is that person who is completely 100% in regards to his akhlaq. So akhlaq has a direct connection to our iman. The better our akhlaq is, the better that we deal with people on a daily basis, the better our iman is. And a very beautiful hadith reported by the Prophet ﷺ, the heaviest thing on the scale of good deeds on the day of Qiyamah will be the good akhlaq of a person. The heaviest thing on the day of Qiyamah, on the scale of good deeds for a person, will be his good akhlaq, or his good conduct, his behavior with other people. And it reminds me of the hadith that we mentioned last week, in regards to a person who comes to the day of Qiyamah with a mountain of good deeds, but leaves with a mountain of bad deeds. The mountain of good deeds is his salah, is his zakah, is his fasting, is his giving of charity, him frequenting the masjid and reading the Quran, etc., etc. But in regards to the rights of people, there was a deficiency. So he came with a mountain of good deeds to the day of Qiyamah, but there was a line of people that was waiting for their deeds, or waiting for their right to be fulfilled on the day of Qiyamah. And how is that done on the day of Qiyamah? His good deeds were given to those people. And so his good deeds started to decrease and decrease because the line of people was long and they wanted their good deeds, they wanted the haq that this person had broken in the dunya, they wanted that reward back. And so his mountain of good deeds completely was wiped out, and then there was still a line of people, so they started to give their bad deeds. And by the end of the hisab, or by the end of reckoning, this person who had initially come with a mountain of good deeds leaves with a mountain of bad deeds. And this is the most wretched person, or the most unfortunate person, according to the Prophet ﷺ, on the day of Qiyamah. And why? It's because he was deficient in regards to how he dealt with other people. He was deficient in regards to fulfilling the behaviors or the etiquette that Islam teaches us in regards to the rights of other people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran mentions in regards to the mercy of the Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضَّلْ غَلِيدَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلَكَ. That it is a mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you, O Prophet of Allah, you are merciful to the people. And there is many occasions where we can read and we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was abused, verbally abused, or physically abused, or there was something done to disrespect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But out of mercy and out of love and out of compassion that the Prophet ﷺ had for them, he forgave them. Or instead of retaliating, the Prophet ﷺ would instead teach them about Islam, they would instead accept Islam. So the Prophet ﷺ is addressed in the Quran directly by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. It is a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you are soft and kind with the people. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضَّلْ غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ. If you had to be harsh, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you had to be harsh, if you had to be strict, if you had to be hard with the way you dealt with people, لَنْفَضُّ مِنْ حَوْلَكَ, then the people around you would have run away from around you. They would have run away from you because of your harshness or your strictness. And instead Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a compassion, a love, a mercy. And this is what attracted other people to Islam. And this is the same principle that we can use today. The better akhlaq that we have today, the more compassion, the more mercy, the more love that we deal with other people with, the more attracted to Islam they will be. And this is where I mentioned where there's a deficiency in our understanding of a religious person. The akhlaq of a person is very important to his deen. And like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, on the day of Qiyamah, the heaviest deed on the scale of good deeds will be a person's akhlaq. One example of once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was physically abused. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once walking and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a cloak with him. He was wearing a cloak, and this cloak was a very thick cloak. The cloth of this cloak was thick, it was rough. And so a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he jerked the cloak of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a very disrespectful manner. Now obviously, even addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a disrespectful manner would be something which would not be tolerated by the Sahaba. But this person came and he took it to another level where he grabbed the cloak and he pulled it. And so by pulling it and grabbing the cloak of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it scratched or it left a mark on the neck of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so the Sahaba around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were obviously very furious, very angry, and they wanted to retaliate. But it was the love and the muhabba, the compassion that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had, that instead of retaliating, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lent him an ear to listen to what had made him so mad. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him what made him so mad and why had he acted in such a way with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so then he replied that maybe in giving out something to do with financial matters, and that he hadn't received enough money and he needed more money. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, instead of retaliating, instead of rebuking him or abusing him or telling him or scolding him, admonishing him, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned around and he smiled. And he lent him an ear and he listened to what the man had to say. And after the man explained his situation and said that I need more money than the money that you have given me, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then ordered the Sahaba to give him the money that he needed. So a person disrespects the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but out of love and compassion, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of the forbearance that he had, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him, he forgives him, he listens to his story, and then he gives him what he needs. Aisha radiallahu anha mentions about the akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she mentions that ما ضرب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم شيئا قط بيده ولا امرأة ولا خادما. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم never hit anyone in his life. Neither his wives, he never abused his wives, neither any of his servants, never did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم ever abuse them, whether physically or verbally. Anas رضي الله عنه was a Sahabi, a companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he was brought into the companionship of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he was very young, around 10 years old. And the Prophet, the mother of Anas radiallahu anhu told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I'm giving you Anas, I'm giving you my son, I'm handing him over to you so that he may stay in your service. And he was only 10 years old at the time. He spent many years with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until the passing away of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he used to mention after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away that I was a servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the many years of his life that I was with him. And never did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever scold me, ever rebuke me, ever ask me why you did this or why you didn't do that. Being a servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, still the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam treated him with love and respect and compassion and mercy. So these are the things that we need to bring into our lives and our daily lives. The people that we deal with, to deal with them in a merciful manner, a compassionate manner, to make sure that we're watching over ourselves in regards to our akhlaq, or our etiquettes, and the way we deal with other people during the day. Now, how do we as Muslims actually bring this into our life? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, obviously by reading his seerah, We will read about the beautiful akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then trying to implement it in our lives. This is very easy. Last week we talked about backbiting, and backbiting and the sins of the mouth have a direct effect or a direct link to our akhlaq. If a person, and this is one of the three ways that the ulama have written to try to improve one's akhlaq, the first way is to just try to control your tongue and what you talk about. Because when you try to control your tongue and what you talk about, it will directly have an effect on what you say. Hence, something that you might have said that might have hurt someone, something that you might say that might hurt someone's heart or might be abusive in some way or manner, you will abstain from this just by watching over your tongue. And so to watch over what we say, to think about what we say before we say it, is the first way that we can actually implement good akhlaq in our life. The Prophet ﷺ was once asked by a Sahabi, the Prophet ﷺ was speaking and he mentioned about the necessity of giving sadaqah or charity. And usually our minds go straight to money, about when we talk about sadaqah, we think about money. So the Sahabi, he asked, O Prophet of Allah, what if a person doesn't have money to give in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the sake of the deen of Allah? So the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, if he doesn't have money, then what's better for him is that he goes out and he earns, and with the money he earns, he should give that in sadaqah. So the Sahabi Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he asked him again, he said, O Prophet of Allah, what if a person doesn't have the energy to go out, to earn, to make money, and then to give it in sadaqah? How is he supposed to give sadaqah or give charity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, if he cannot give money, neither can he earn money, then what's better for him is to at least command people to do good, and this will be a form of sadaqah for him. You will have, to command other people to pray, to stay away from haram. This will be a form of sadaqah for this person, and this will, he will fulfill the necessity of giving sadaqah for the sake of Allah. And so he mentioned, O Prophet of Allah, what if he's not even able to do that? What if he can't even tell other people? He doesn't have he doesn't have the courage to go around commanding other people to do good. What is he supposed to do if he doesn't have money? And if he can't earn money and give money for the sake of Allah? What if he can't, command other people to do good? What should he do then? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he should hold himself from causing any difficulty to anyone else, and this will be a means of sadaqah. So when we hold ourselves, or when we refrain from causing difficulty to anyone else, this is also a form of sadaqah. This is also a form of good deed. When we hold ourselves, refrain from saying anything that will hurt someone else, from doing anything that will hurt someone else. That's why before speaking and before doing anything, it's important that we think about it. Am I hurting anyone in any way by what am I about to say or what I'm about to do? And by doing this, this is a form of sadaqah and also a means of correcting our akhlaq. Secondly, the ulama mentioned that we should try reading the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And by reading the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we will see the good akhlaq that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had, the situations that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through, and how to deal with them. When a person reads about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his life, and how he dealt with certain issues at certain times in his life, then we will also be encouraged to be like the Prophet ﷺ and have that same sense of rahmah, that same sense of mercy and compassion for those around us. And the third way the ulama mentioned is to stay away from anger and get used to forgiving other people. And obviously we know anger is a means of retaliation. It's a means of, it's something that gets a person going, and a person out of rage may do something that he doesn't even know what he's doing. So when a person, he stays away from anger, and he becomes used to forgiving other people, then this will obviously help him in making his akhlaq better and becoming a better person in regards to how we are around around the people that we're around on a daily basis. Now, staying away from anger, and the topic of anger is a whole different topic on its own. And obviously it's something that's something that can be read about and looked into. But just simply about anger, the Prophet ﷺ once saw two people arguing, and they became very heated in their argument and their debate, so much so that their faces turned red and the veins on their face started to protrude. And so the Prophet ﷺ saw these two people arguing, and the Prophet ﷺ mentioned to those around him that I know such a saying, that if these two people have to say it, or they have to utter these words, their anger will dissipate, their anger will go away. And so the Sahaba asked, O Prophet of Allah, what are these words? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that if simply one of them just had to say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim, then the anger that is boiling inside him will go away. And why is it? It's because when we say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim, we're seeking refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from shaitan the accursed. And who is the one that is causing the anger in us to boil, or who is the one that is inciting us to debate and to argue? It's shaitan. So when a person seeks refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from shaitan the accursed, he's seeking refuge from all the evil that shaitan may tempt him to do. And so ulama mentioned that in regards to any temptations that we may find in our daily life, whether it's anger, whether it has to do with a sin, a person just recites the isti'adha and says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim. It will be a means of seeking refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from shaitan the accursed, be a means of his anger dissipating, be a means of coming close to the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the third thing that the ulama mentioned in trying to better our akhlaq was staying away from anger and be quick in forgiving other people. And they're obviously interconnected. When a person becomes angry, it's hard for him to forgive another person. Now on a more, something that's applicable to today's life, it's usually attitudes that anger us. It's usually something someone said. Maybe it's something that somebody does. Maybe at home, maybe at work, maybe in class. Between friends. Sometimes it's just something that they said or something they did which ticks us off or which it creates anger within us. And so to say A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim to let the anger go away and be quick in forgiving if he hurts you in any other way in regards to saying something or doing something, be quick in forgiving and asking and forgiving him and letting him know that you forgave him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be forgiving to us insha'Allah. In regards to forgiveness, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions when a person forgives someone on the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him. In regards to hiding sins, and this is also a part of akhlaq, in regards to hiding sins, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions مَنْ نَفَّسَ عَنْ مُؤْمِنٍ كُرْبَةً مِنْ كُرْبِ الدُّنْيَا نَفَّسَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ كُرْبَةً مِنْ كُرْبِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَمَنْ سَتَرَ مُسْلِمًا سَتَرَهُ اللَّهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. A person who removes a difficulty of another person in this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove his difficulty on the day of Qiyamah. A person who hides a person's sins in this world, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hide his sins in this world as well as in the hereafter. So these are all types of akhlaq or types of etiquettes and morals and behavior that we need to bring into our lives. Like I said, akhlaq is a long topic. For us to read the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or any book that focuses in on the akhlaq of Islam, the akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's important, and then try to implement it in our lives. This will be a means of completing our faith. Like I mentioned, salah, zakah, sawm, these are all foundations of our deen, and the beautification of our deen is through our akhlaq. So a house without the foundation is useless, and a house without the rest of the house besides the foundation is also useless. We should try to perfect both parts of our deen, our akhlaq, as well as the foundation of our deen, our salah, our iman, our zakah, our sawm. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, to guide us, to keep us away from all harm. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq, to bring good akhlaq into our lives. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us a means of guidance for our families, for our friends, for those around us. Just before I end, inshallah, two quick announcements in regards to the Islamic school. The children who attend the Islamic school, there will be a picnic for them as well as their parents. Held at Hatters Park today from 4:30 to 7:30. They will receive their report cards the end of the year, inshallah, before Ramadan comes in. Also on Sunday, inshallah, from Asr to Maghrib, Asr being 6:30 p.m., we will have a halaqa, our monthly community halaqa, in regards to fasting and Ramadan, the who, what, when, where, whys of Ramadan, fasting, all that will be covered, inshallah, on Sunday after Asr Salah, which is at 6:30 p.m. سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.